Okay, let me introduce Kevin without further ado. I'm going to give a short introduction. I've already apologized, but I'd rather have him speak rather than me, so I'm going to make it short. But essentially, I've known Kevin for a very long time. We must have been very little kids way back then. Because we were at neighboring universities. I guess we both started our career at the neighboring universities in Southern Ontario. I was at the University of Waterloo, and he was at the University of Western Ontario, what it was called then. Kevin has a PhD from Princeton University in Sociology and Demography. He was the director of the Population Studies Center at Western and chair of the Department of Sociology. I think you were chair when I evaluated the department. Well, it was on an evaluation.
That's right.
I think
yes,
so.
Yes, you're right.
That was a long time ago. They invite little kids into evaluating the department. He moved to the University of Calgary as Dean of Social Science in 2007 and is now Professor of Sociology at the University of Calgary and Deputy Provost of the University. His major work, he's also a research affiliate of The Prentice. Never mind all this important stuff. That's the real one. That's the big one. His work is mainly in the area of historical demography, including his book on culture, religion, and demographic behavior, published by McGill Queen's Press and University of Liverpool Press, and continuing interests in Canadian population trends on issues of family change and evolving labor market. I will mention just briefly that Kevin and I were two-fifths of the executive committee for the Population Change and Life Course Cluster, which was funded by SHRC for $2.1 million over 7 years and is now just winding down. So we work closely together on that. And most recently, we were part of a roundtable at the School of Policy Studies at the University of Calgary on changing labor markets in Alberta and Canada. So essentially, I've known Kevin for a long time. So I was delighted that he's coming here to talk about, are we missing the big picture, the focus on individual level data and demographic research. And he said he's going to talk for about 30 to 40 minutes, so there'll be lots of time for questions, and we'll welcome that, of course. So welcome, Kevin. We're
great.
Glad you're here.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I'm really delighted to be here today. I've followed the fortunes of the Prentice Center since its beginning. In fact, I was here, I think, before Susan came, when there was an inaugural panel to talk about plans for the Prentice Center. Even before that, I remember at Western, where we had a population study center for a long time, and I still remember us gathering on Friday, just as you do here. And we were reading in the newspaper about this wonderful donation to start the Prentice Center, and we were asking ourselves, you know, what are we doing wrong? I mean, we've been around a long time, no one's ever given us a nickel. We really need to rethink how we strategize about things. So it's just great to have the chance to come here, and I'm very grateful that you've asked me to come and speak. What I thought I would do today, and I echo Susan's comments that on the Friday before Thanksgiving weekend, I'm very happy to see that some of you have dedicated the time to come out. And I thought I would maybe do something a little bit different than normally when I've given talks in various colloquium series, where I tended to focus on one piece of research that I've been involved in, and that's obviously often very empirical and so on. And I'd maybe step back and look a little bit at where our discipline stands today, how some things have changed over time, and maybe, as the title suggests, are we missing some things that are important? Missing might be too strong, maybe not paying sufficient attention to some of the things that are maybe really important in the field of population studies. I say it, I guess, as a career demographer who really committed to the idea that demography is just central to understanding the society that we live in. Might not quite echo David Foote's famous comments about, you know, demography explains two-thirds of everything. But I do feel in almost all the big social issues that we're thinking about and struggling with today, that there really is a very important demographic component. And that sometimes maybe that gets squeezed out a little bit, or that perhaps the way we have been building our research programs of late maybe doesn't pay quite as much attention as it might to some of the classical questions in demography that I don't think really have been answered and I think are really very important today. And part of the reason I think it's important to look at this is that I think some of those questions have very, very important implications for social policy. Whereas some of the stuff that I see my younger colleagues doing, which is absolutely top quality research, I don't want to be misinterpreted to be criticizing what many people in the field, young and old, are doing these days. But I think we've maybe moved a little bit further away from focusing on questions that have real policy implications, or at least the chain from the research to social policy is maybe a bit longer than it might have been with some of the other issues that we've talked about. So let me get right into this, and you'll hopefully see where I'm going with things. Just the up key, I guess, we'll do it. Move it forward.
Side key.
There we go. So I'm not going to give you my first two or three lectures of my population course, which talk about some of the issues up here. I just draw your attention to the fact that all of you know, if you've been involved with demography, that really in the classical sense, demography was always focused on the study of populations. And that meant typically looking at nations, at regions, and focusing on aggregate data. So I won't rehearse all of the stuff from Malthus and Marx and the demographic transition theory and so on, but for those of you who know the literature in this area, really we were looking at population characteristics of societies or indeed even at the global level. So Malthus, who many of us would probably see as the founder of what we think of as modern demography today, was very much looking, of course, at the relationship between rates of population growth and the consequences for society, economically and we might say in terms of the ecology as well. And you know the dismal story that Malthus would tell about high rates of population growth and how that was fated in some sense to undermine social progress. And whether we are supporters of Malthus or opponents of Malthus, in some sense he set the tone early for how we think about population and societies. Looking at characteristics not of individuals but of a group of people. Is that population growing fast? Is it based on high fertility? Is fertility outstripping mortality? And what are some of the consequences of that for society? As critical as Marx, of course, was of Malthus, again, there was a sense of looking at the broad societal perspective. The essential feature, of course, of Marx's work in refuting, in his view, much of what Malthus had said, it really focused on the relationship between population and unemployment. And of course, some of you, if you've taken my course, but I'm sure taking other courses, you would know that Marx's basic view is we didn't have a problem of overpopulation. It wasn't a question of too many people around. Really was a question of an economic system that led to a permanent level of unemployment, whether population was growing fast or growing slow. So again, really focusing on the broader economy, on the broader society. Maybe much of 20th century demography, of course, was built around the notion of the demographic transition. Arguably one of the most important ideas, I think, that had been introduced into the field of population studies. And again, I won't rehearse a very, very long debate about the demographic transition, but really what people were struggling to understand is how we had gone from a situation that probably had prevailed in human societies for a very long period of time, a situation in which we had high birth rates and high death rates, and over time we saw very, very limited population growth. Some of you have probably seen in population textbooks or in lectures those graphs that we would often like to show that shows the human population kind of a flat line for a long, long period of time until we get to around the late 18th century, the beginnings of what we'd often call the Industrial Revolution, and then we saw this enormous increase in population that carried into the 20th century. I always have a little chart that I show my students when I'm teaching population that it took all of human history up until somewhere around 1800 for the world population to reach a billion. And then by 1920, there were 2 billion. And then by 1950 or something, there were 3 billion, and so on. You'll still see articles in the press every time we pass one of these great milestones, when the world population turns 6 billion or 7 billion, and people like Susan and I are guaranteed to get phone calls from the media on those days. You know, is this the end of the world? Now, you know, we hit a total population of 6 billion or 7 billion or whatever else it is. But I think what we were thinking about a lot in demography during that whole period, I'd say the late part of the 20th century for sure, was the notion of what's happened and what's driven these kinds of changes. What led initially to human societies breaking out of this long-term stability, beginning to grow rapidly. And then, of course, in the more recent period, what led to the declines in population rates that are bringing us to a level where we can start thinking about stability in the global population, perhaps sometime later in this century. Really an extraordinary change. When I started in demography, it was very much that time of crisis, of population growing rapidly, threatening the foundations of our society, certainly threatening our standards of living. Some of you may remember Paul Ehrlich's famous book, The Population Bomb, the first edition I think came out in 1968, in which he was basically saying, it's over. You know, it's too late. There's a disastrous situation in terms of human population growth. It will destroy much of the foundations of modern society, and of course we know that that really hasn't come about. So my goal isn't really to sort of rehearse the history of demographic theory, it's just to make the point that I think traditionally we thought about population mostly at the aggregate level, as characteristics of societies. Is it growing fast? Is it growing slow? Is it based on high fertility? Is it based on a combination of high fertility, high mortality, and so on? And I think what we've seen is an increasing shift that I want to talk about a little bit. So I'll just skip right over this because I don't want to take too much of your time. Just add one point to it maybe, and that's that if we think about things methodologically, and when I think back to my training, my painful first graduate course in demographic analysis, again, we usually talked about measures that referred to populations. So we spent a lot of time looking at crude and refined rates, you know, crude birth rates to total fertility rates to net reproduction rates and so on. Spent a lot of time looking at how we used life tables to measure mortality patterns and so on. And what we often called indirect methods of estimation. So how can you estimate the fertility rate of a society when you don't have very good data on births and so on? The first course I took at the graduate level was somebody who's long passed away now, about 15 years, Ansley Cole, whose name some of you still may run into if you're reading in the area of demography. And he was very, very much in that tradition. In fact, we often used to say that he really wasn't interested in much beyond getting the numbers right, which was certainly unfair to him. But his real passion was seeing, it is almost a kind of puzzle of how do you properly calculate rates of change and rates of growth within populations. He used to, when I was in class with him, we got to the section that he wasn't very interested in about the social determinants of fertility. And there was a book that came out back in the early 60s by a man named Pascal Welton that was called Social and Economic Factors Affecting Fertility. That was on our reading list. And Cole, I always remember in class saying, you know, he really should have called it Social and Economic Factors Barely Affecting Fertility because he felt the results were so weak and we didn't really understand much of this at all. So the point I just want to make really is that I think for a long period of time, demography was really very much about studying the movement of populations over time, at looking at rates of behavior, whether migration or fertility or whatever it was, and thinking about the determinants of that, again, at the societal level, at characteristics of the society. How did industrialization, for example, affect population change? And I think we've seen over the last, 20 or 30 years, a major shift in terms of how we approach demography. And I just want to say right now, in case I misinterpreted, that I think it's been a largely positive one. I think there was that kind of frustration with an old, very narrow connection to demographic issues that ignored a lot of the social, psychological factors even that affect elements of demographic behavior. I think there was also a sense that you could only go so far with aggregate level measures and that you really needed data about individuals to understand many of the things that we're interested in. So, as I say, I applaud much of what has gone on in demographic studies in the last 20, 30 years. I just worry, my basic point, that maybe we've shifted the focus a little too much in the other direction. So I just spent a few words on the question of how this all came about and what I think has brought us to the situation where we are now. When I find, if I go to a population meeting, almost all of the papers, and especially papers by younger scholars, will be using individual level data, typically some form of survey data that collects information about the individuals, and we're trying to explain things very much at the individual level. Some of it, I think, started with the early fertility surveys. In the post-World War II period, for the first time, really, we were in a position where we could use modern survey techniques to ask people about their behavior. So we weren't just calculating birth rates, we were going to real people, typically only women in those days, and asking them about their situation in terms of how many children they would like to have, and then measuring how many children were actually born to them. And then we were looking at that in relation to characteristics of the women, or often the women and their spouses, or in that period of time, we actually used the word their husbands, because most of the early surveys only interviewed legally married women. And I think it started us in that direction, again, absolutely valuable, of looking at how characteristics like the level of education, or whether or not a woman was working, or her religious affiliation, how those things affected both people's desires with respect to fertility, how many children would I like to have, or their actual behavior, how many children did a particular woman end up with. In Canada, I think one of the big things that came along was the introduction of the public use sample files from the census. And the first ones came in 1971. And it was just an historic movement. Instead of just having those big old census books that you would go through that had data broken down by province and age of women and so on, we actually could start using the individual census records in a data file. That, of course, evolved into the kinds of files we have now down the hall in your research data center. In the late 80s and into the 90s, we had another huge step forward in Canada. Some might call it the golden era of Statistics Canada, perhaps, when we started to have major national surveys, often longitudinal surveys, which followed individuals over time. There was the National Longitudinal Study of Children and Youth, a survey of labor income dynamics, the Youth in Transition surveys that came out, that just brought an enormous wealth of data. And with that, of course, came a different method of analysis, and one that became much easier because of the development of new kinds of software, and of course, very, very powerful computers that could allow us to do sophisticated analysis of big, big data sets, sitting in our jammies in our basement if we wanted to do that kind of thing. It's extraordinary in some sense, again, if you've had a pretty long career like I have, to think of how that has changed over time. When I the first methods and statistics course I ever took as an undergraduate at the University of Toronto, I actually learned how to program in Fortran. And some of you probably don't even know what Fortran is, but an old programming language that I can remember taking days to get my program to work to do a simple cross-tabulation with two variables in it. And then we got the beginnings of statistical packages, SPSS and so on, Stata that's increasingly used today, that really allow us to do extraordinary types of statistical analysis with really tremendous ease, and indeed not even with a fully profound understanding sometimes of the statistical methods, and I'll be the first to admit I'm one of them. I have used, you know, proportional hazards models and so on in my work. If you ask me to really explain the foundations, mathematical or statistical point of view, I couldn't do it. But I understand the point of it, why we would use this, when we would use it, and hopefully can interpret things correctly. And I think the combination of those things, you know, our increasing interest, of course, in the role of the individual, the new types of data that have become available, and the developments in terms of statistical analysis have really helped us to look at a huge array of questions and to produce some very, very important results. But sometimes, I think, we find ourselves in situations where I'd almost say we're getting to the point of diminishing returns, where we know a fair bit, and that's important about certain topics. Not too much, too sure often how much more we can go, adding another variable or two, reformulating our model somewhat, doesn't always do the trick, so to speak. And I think sometimes in particular, because of my increasing interest in social policy, that we sometimes find ourselves in situations where it really doesn't always present, I would say, a basis that people in government or in positions of public policy formation could really do a whole lot with what it is we're presenting to them. And I think as we work with our younger colleagues, with graduate students, young faculty members, and so on, sensitizing them to a little bit to what you need in terms of how you present the results of your work if you're interested in influencing social policy is something we have to work on. So I've just picked two, and I could have picked many, many more. But two problems where we have seen real advances, I think, because of the level of data that are available, and where I think we understand in broad terms the situation in terms of individual determinants of those kinds of behavior. So take the example of teen pregnancy. I mean, this has been a problem studied by sociologists, epidemiologists, demographers for a long period of time. Generally, I think those studies come up with pretty much the same kind of findings at the individual level. The determinants of early pregnancy are pretty consistent, haven't changed a whole lot over time, and they're even pretty consistent across societies. And that's important that we know that. But what we see is that there's some interesting changes at the aggregate level. So it's a good example to me of a situation where even if individual determinants haven't changed much, we may see important differences at the aggregate level that we really need to struggle to explain. So I just give you a little bit of data that I pulled from the United States in an article recently from the Centers for Disease Control, really shows something interesting. It looks at essentially birth rates for young women 15 to 19 by race and ethnicity. And I think what's interesting is that the ranking of it hasn't really changed too much. There's a little bit of variation there, but basically some minority groups continue to have higher levels of teen pregnancy than other groups. The Asian Pacific Islander group is consistently at the bottom. And the interesting thing is it's come down for everybody. So if you ask what are the determinants at an individual level, things like education, you know, family status and so on, things that have been important for a long time, still important today. But there has been an interesting change at the aggregate level that we need to think about. Immigration and health is another one. I brought this up because the last couple of conferences that I've been at, a lot of young people, smart graduate students, looking at this issue. And again, I won't go through all of the literature on this, but there's kind of an interesting thing we see in a lot of societies like Canada, where there's also often the sort of healthy immigrant effect, people call it. Immigrants come to Canada, the United States, wherever. There's a sense in which they have higher life expectancy than native-born populations. Lower age-specific death rates, perhaps. And then what we find is that they're in the country for a longer period of time, that divergence starts to shrink, and their mortality patterns often come to more closely resemble that of the native population. And there's been a big debate about this. Is there some sort of selection effect? I mean, we know immigrants, particularly coming to a country like Canada, tend to be more privileged in their home society, higher levels of education, and so on. Does it depend on the level of integration of a particular group in society? Is there some elements of discrimination involved? Important topics, but again, one where I think we've come to a sense of a pretty good understanding of the situation in terms of the individual determinants, but it's not so clear that we necessarily have an understanding at the societal level, and especially an understanding of what governments might do in these situations. So, and I don't say this in any way to mock this young graduate student who was presenting the paper, but he started talking about some of the policy implications after going through some work on immigrants and health. And somebody said, well, what could governments really do in this situation? And the student said, well, I think governments really need to address this because, you know, immigrants come to the country having an advantage in terms of health, and that's disappearing, and we have to be sure that they continue to have better health than native-born Canadians. I said, boy, I wouldn't want to be the minister and try and defend that issue. But I think it just sort of pointed to the fact that we often push our students to come up with some policy implications at the end of their paper, but we haven't really talked too much about how that can really come about. The complexity of social policy and whether the kinds of findings we have could ever be ones that really are of sufficient importance to justify all that's involved in government introducing new policies. So I think in some sense, and again, I just want to underline the point that I'm not suggesting that we shouldn't be doing this kind of work. Of course we should. And it's been a huge step forward having the kind of data sets we have that allow us to look in fine-grained detail at some of these problems. So some of our health surveys provide a wealth of data on the individuals in the survey that allow us to look at the determinants of a variety of different behaviors, and all that's good. But there's a bigger picture maybe sometimes that gets lost in our attention to these fairly fine differences. So let me just try to suggest that what we might do a little bit differently, not to replace the work I've been talking about, but maybe to supplement. The basic point I want to make is there are a number of issues that I think demographers used to pay a lot of attention to and used to focus more on, as I say, the aggregate level, the broad social level, that we've kind of lost a little bit of interest in. And yet I think many of these issues are extraordinarily important. And the link to social policy is a little bit clearer, maybe, than it is with some of the work that we've done focusing on individual differences in behavior. So I'm going to talk just briefly about three that I haven't picked at random. They're things I've been working on a little bit myself and naturally think are particularly important issues to be thinking about. So one comes from some work I did, as Susan was talking about, with the School of Public Policy at the University of Calgary, where they had asked me to do a paper on labor markets. And I'll tell you a story that, again, some younger colleagues in the room might be interested in. They had asked me to do this paper, and of course I spent a lot of time reading through the literature, putting all of this together and so on. I was pretty happy with the paper, actually, by the time I got it done. The School of Policy has a full-time communications person who's worked in the broadcast industry and so on. sent him the paper and to look it over, because they do a little press release and so on. And I said, so what'd you think? He said, I think it's a great paper. But you got to have a different title. Like, no one's going to read it with that title that you have. So they got a much trendier title that they put on the paper. God, I'm blanking on what it was now. All the workers we need. It was a paper on the labor market, kind of challenging the ideas that there's, you know, a shortfall in terms of the labor market that's related to population aging and so on. And I had some boring academic title like, you know, population aging in a labor market or something. He said, no, let's call it All the Workers We Need, the myth of Canada's labor supply shortage or so on. I said, okay, you're an expert, I'll go along with it. And so he said, okay, I'm gonna get this out into the whole, you know, communications world. I thought, yeah, probably like other papers I've had, two or three people maybe give you a call and so on. It just bowled over. I got in the next day, they'd set up a little press conference in a room like this. A couple of reporters there answered questions. I was done in about 45 minutes out of there. I thought, oh, I guess that's the end of it. He says, hey, no, come back to the office with me. And he said, I've got a number of things lined up for you. And I've got this out on the wire. You know, the other stuff's going to start rolling in. I thought, yeah, right. So it ends up, you know, I ended up doing Power and Politics and a couple of other national TV shows. And I was on radio talk shows all across the country and so on. Just amazing, I think. Susan, of course, has always been much, much better at this and much quoted in the papers and so on. But it struck me that, this is a bit of a side, that one of the things we have to do is, if we want our work to have some influence, is really make it known that people are interested in a lot of the stuff that we do. We tend to bury it because we've come out of an academic setting with kind of boring titles and we don't work hard enough on our abstract to really get our points across. When we do it, there's a lot of interest out there, and people are interested in what we say. I remember when I was dean, I used to work on our faculty all the time about this. And people would say, nobody cares about what we do. I'd say, it's not true. Like, reporters call all the time. And yeah, sometimes they ask goofy questions. They don't really understand the issue, and they pick up on things we don't think are all that significant, but people are really interested in what social scientists do. It talks about the lives of ordinary people, and I just feel part of my responsibility, being effectively paid by my students and taxpayers, is to provide some of that information back to them. So anyway, that's a bit of an aside, but this is how I got into this issue of looking at internal migration. And I started, hadn't done this for a long time, I started looking at a lot of the work that had been done on internal migration, and it's great. And again, far better today than it was 25 or 30 years ago, because we have great data. In many cases, we have things like the public use sample tapes or other kinds of large survey data that are there. The interesting thing I sort of found, though, is that in terms of looking at determinants of internal migration at the individual level, I haven't changed all that much. Things like age and education still matter today as they did 30 years ago. One of the classic graphs in demography is sort of age graph of internal migration rates by age. And we all know this because we've all done it. You know, your late teens into your early 20s, you're much more likely to pick up and move somewhere else. You're going to school, you're finishing school, getting your first job, maybe moving off for family reasons and so on, and then you get into your 30s and you start having kids and you have a mortgage and it just becomes a whole lot more difficult to move. And then we see a little bit of a bump around the traditional retirement ages where people make a change again. The interesting thing is that doesn't seem to have changed all that much in most advanced industrialized societies. But one of the things that's been happening is that we've seen some very puzzling changes, which include declines in the rates of internal migration. And so this is just some data that I put together from the censuses of Canada from 1981 to 2006, We ask people about where you lived 5 years ago. Was it in a different city, different province, and so on? And what we find, it's not huge, but it's pretty interesting, that rates have been declining over time. And you know, if we look at people 25 to 34, we might say real peak beginning of career kind of ages. Lots of people would be moving around. Yeah, but it's going down. And that's really kind of puzzling. I felt it again, I must say, when I was dean, that how hard it often was to get people to move. You know, you have a job available, bring them in for an interview, you wine them and dine them and tell them what a wonderful place it is, and sure, you know, I'll do this for you and I'll give you a startup grant and I'll paint your office or whatever the heck it was. And then they call back and say, yeah, no, I'm not going to come. You know, I've got a lot of things here, and you know, my spouse has a job or whatever else it is. So it's a very interesting kind of thing, because when I talk about this in class, I always say to the students, isn't it easier now to move than it's ever been before? You know, we have good transportation, so you can go back home and visit much more easily than would have been true in the past. We have unbelievable communications. My oldest son lives in Guatemala. I talk to him 3 times a week on Skype. He's got a baby now, baby's on the camera, so I can see how he's growing and so on. Communications are so much easier, transportation is so much easier. Wouldn't we think that people would move more easily? I often tell the students the story of my wife's parents, who came, as many immigrants did, to Canada after the Second World War. Father came on his own, was working in agriculture. About a year or so later, his wife and young child came along. They didn't speak the language. When they came, they assumed they'd never go back. And in fact, were in Canada 15 years before they ever saw any of their relatives back in Germany again, when they finally flew back sometime in the late 1960s for the first time for a visit. And so it's always seemed to me that it should be easier. We should see more migration, but we don't. And the point, I'm not here to discuss exactly why that's true, but I think what's interesting is that, again, you can have this stability and determinants at the individual level. Still true that younger people are more likely to move than people in their 40s or 50s. Still true, sorry, that more educated people are more likely to move than less educated people. And that's true at high levels or low levels of migration. But what we've seen is a very important change in terms of migration rates. And that has huge consequences, especially for a country like Canada. We've talked about this a lot in Alberta. Less so today, obviously, as the economy has turned, but last couple of years, labor shortages, very low unemployment rates in Alberta, very high unemployment rates in other parts of the country, and yet difficult to get people to move. Is there a role for policy? What might it be? Does our unemployment insurance system affect the movement of people? There are other things that we could do that would make it easier for people to move. Really important, I think, social questions, and ones that it's easier for us to think about when we see information at the aggregate level. So let me go through two others really quickly. Another thing I've been working on is changes in population distribution. And this, again, I think is extraordinarily important for Canada. On so many dimensions, we're seeing this huge difference between the eastern provinces and the western provinces. Very slow growth and rapid aging in many parts of eastern Canada. We're seeing the decline of small town Canada in many rural areas. The paper I'm working on, given the advice from my communications buddy, I've been toying with the title, The Death of Small Town Canada. It's not quite the death, but we see population decline in lots of parts of Canada today. And that can set off what we might call a vicious cycle of population decline. As people start to leave, other people say, why am I staying here? And we can find places in Canada. Their population is aging rapidly. Birth rates are low, international immigrants are not attracted there because it's not a great situation to go into, and local young people leave, which leads to this kind of self-fulfilling cycle of decline. And we can think a little bit about the implications of that for public policy. When we look at some towns that are shrinking in terms of population, very old populations. We see many places in Canada where the median age is over 50 now. How do you provide the kinds of services to people who live in those communities? How do you attract young doctors or nurses to settle in communities that look like they're in steep decline? Important questions, and again, what I think that we need to take a look at. I'll skip over this to save a little bit of time. Maybe I'll just say, point to one or two things. The kinds of differences we see in age structures and growth across Canada now is phenomenal. At the extremes, Portage-la Prairie and Manitoba, between 2001 and 2011, lost 37% of its population. Okotoks, not far from us, more than doubled during that period of time. Median age, 30 in Grand Prairie, almost 60 in Parksville, BC. So huge, huge differences across the country. I thought I'd bring you one good example since it would have some local flavor to it. We could compare Lethbridge with Shawinigan, Quebec. Who's from Shawinigan?
Jean Chrétien,
our former prime minister, ninth of 19 children, by the way, not too many people know that, from the old days of high fertility. Look at the incredible difference between these two communities. Lethbridge grown by over 20% between 2001 and 11. Median age of the population, less than 37. Little over 4% of the population, over 80. About 1.8 persons age 18 to 34, young, energetic, getting into the labor force, compared to the number 65 plus. A lot of people from elsewhere, only 64% of the population is third generation Canadian. Average value, this is of course reported by people in the National Household Survey, probably not entirely accurate, but average dwelling value about $280,000. Shawinigan, 2001-2011 shrunk, down by 2.5%. Median age of the population, 50. Half the people in the town over age 50. 7% over age 80. Less than one young person for every individual over 65. Almost everybody, old line, third generation or more Canadian, houses not worth a whole lot. I put in the housing thing because it really ties to that other issue of migration. A real problem a lot of older people face in smaller communities is their kids move off. And they might like to follow them, but how could they do it? I mean, imagine if your kids had gone to Montreal in the case of Shawinigan, and you wanted to go and live and be closer with them. You sell your house for $125,000 and you move to Montreal, what are you going to do? It'd be almost impossible to survive in those kinds of situations. So we're seeing enormous differences across parts of the country, and I think looking at that information about communities is very important. And finally, and I'll do this quickly because I don't want to take any more of your time and I'm interested in your ideas and questions. To me, the single biggest question in front of us today is what the future of our economy looks like. There was just an article that came out yesterday and I was going to bring along some of the data, but I thought that would stretch it out even more. But looking at the declines after that resurgence following the Great Recession of 2008-09, 2010-11-12, economies were starting to pick up, rates of growth were increasing. Now they're dropping again almost everywhere. The United States, a bit of an exception, but even it is starting to see signs now again of something of a slowdown. Lots of worries about the situation in China. Lots of worries about the situation in Europe. We're asking ourselves, are we still in recovery, as some people would argue, from the Great Recession of 2008? Some people argue recessions built on the kind of financial crisis we saw then often take a long, long time for things to get better. that could be true, and supports the argument that we need bigger investment from government in the economy to try to boost the rate of economic growth? Or have we moved into a very, very different period? Are we at the beginning of something that's going to look very different from what most of us have lived through, where we took rates of growth of, say, 3% in the economy as sort of average? And in good times, real booms, we'd get 4%, 4.5%, 5% economic growth. And why might that come about? And I don't have the answer, and I'm not pretending that I do, but I think there really is a situation in which we need to at least think about the demographics of it and how that might be affecting our future. There's a long period of slow growth we know leads to population aging, and eventually, depending on, of course, immigration patterns and changes in labor force participation and so on, but eventually is likely to lead to a declining labor force. Is that going to affect our future? But in addition, the thing I think people talk less about is that a population that's growing slowly and that's relatively old, one in which demand declines, and consequently, there's less incentive to invest. Many economists today are puzzled by the fact that interest rates are basically zero in real terms. In fact, in Germany, if you buy a German bond, it pays a negative interest rate. Is that a reflection of the fact that there's really no incentive to invest, and it's partially, many other factors involved, but of course, but partially related to the changes we've seen in demography? So again, I'm not going to burden you with all kinds of numbers, but there's a few things that I thought maybe were just interesting to take a look at to get you to think about that. We've got a lot of countries around the world now, and I just put four, there are many others, that have had low fertility for a long period of time. When I say low, I mean not Canada level low, significantly lower. So Germany, I've showing you stuff from the late 1990s up until now, but Germany has had a very low fertility rate stretching back into the 1970s. Those of you who, maybe not demographers, we use the term total fertility rate. It's an estimate of the average number of children a woman would bear over the course of her lifetime if current rates were to prevail throughout her childbearing period. So Germany, average woman produces somewhere around 1.4 children in her lifetime. Been true for a long period of time. Southern Europe, Italy, could add in Portugal, Greece, Spain, very, very low fertility, now stretching back into the 80s and 90s. Japan, long period of time now, of very low fertility. And what we're seeing is much, much lower rates of economic growth than we had become accustomed to in the past. Even Germany, that we think of the powerhouse in all, often call it the powerhouse of Europe. Look what the average rate of growth of the GDP has been over the last 20 years. It's never exceeded 2%. Japan been struggling through a long, long period of time of very slow growth. And they've tried various things in terms of running budget deficits and different things with the currency and so on, kind of stuck in period of very low economic growth. Is it purely a demographic factor? No. Is demography irrelevant to this? I would say no as well. And I think it's an issue we really, really have to think about for the future, particularly because one of the most puzzling things that demographers had never talked about, as far as I know, is we always assumed the aging of the population, the movement of the baby boom in a country like Canada into retirement would create huge opportunities for young people. Be easier than ever. I said that to my students, somewhat embarrassedly, I admit, 10 and 15 years ago. Oh, when old guys like me start moving out of the labor force, there's going to be all kinds of jobs for you people. And yet we're finding in lots of industrialized countries, young people having a really hard time getting into the labor market. High unemployment, precarious work that many of them are involved in. So a hugely, hugely important question. So what's really my point? Final things I'd leave you with is we need to think about the balance in terms of different styles of research that we do, not just in demography, but in the related social sciences, in sociology and economics and political science and so on. We need to think about that balance between the focus on the individual and the, how characteristics of individuals shape their behavior, but we also need to think about the broader picture at the societal level as well. We need to really, if we're going to, in a sense, sell ourselves to the public, who after all fund most of what we do, we need to really think about the links between research and public policy. What kinds of issues really are susceptible to being influenced in positive ways by public policy? Lots of the things we study probably are not. Either they're too complicated for public policy to deal with, or would not be broadly perceived as being important enough to really demand a significant change in the way we do business or a significant investment of money. And I underline the fact, and I take this from years of talking to people in Ottawa and elsewhere, that policy is very difficult to enact. I think often, as academics, we do our research and we say, oh, they should change that. Oh, you know, that unemployment insurance thing doesn't work. You know, that treating different parts of the country differently, you know, you got to work longer in Alberta than you do in Nova Scotia to collect unemployment insurance. Stupid. All economists say that. Get rid of it. Not so easy to do. Lots of factors that weigh on changing policy. And so we need to have a pressing case. We have a hugely important role to play. I mean, I profoundly believe that the social sciences can have an enormous role for good in our society. But we need to think about how we're working on various problems and how we can present our results in a compelling way that will have a positive influence on society. So let me stop there, and I'm happy to answer questions.